and we will not be taking any questions from Facebook, but we do have information officers standing by to get those answered as quickly as possible. So the fire is, as of this morning, 1,226 acres, and we have 150 firefighters with more coming to assist in suppressing the Cambria fire. Our speakers this evening are Jeremy Goers, the Westone Fire Management Officer of the North Dakota National Forest, and then we have Daniel Nyga, the Deputy Disaster Manager for Clackamas County, and Kurt Abbott, the Deputy Forest Supervisor for Mount Hood National Forest, and Evan Flo, our Incident Commander for Great Basin Team 1. So to start it off, I'm going to have Jeremy Doris come up. And like I said, please save all questions for the end.
Thank you. My name is Jeremy Goers. I am the Mount Hood Westone Fire Management Officer. So on August 25th at 2:50 in the morning, we got a notification from Portland General Electric's Canada AI camera of a fire in Bull Run. At 3:30 in the morning, we had engines from the Forest Service, from Midland Fire,
from Corbett, and from Clackamas Fire.
At the time, incident commander showed up. They were calling it 10 acres, burning in heavy fuels. Moderate fire behavior, so just kind of crawling on the ground, maybe getting up in the trees a little bit. 0700, we're able to GPS the fire at 33 acres, so pretty good growth in a matter of a couple hours. Started getting crews on the scene at about 0900. 10 o'clock, we had helicopters already on scene, pulling water from the reservoir and dropping it on the fire. At 12 o'clock, we started to get our first hot shot crews. We had our first retarder drop at 1 o'clock in the afternoon, and then started to get crews throughout the day. And so by the end of the day, it was 60 acres they were estimating it at, and at that point, we had between 80 and 100 people on there. So really, really fortunate to have the partners that we have that helped us out that first day, and it was really an incredible response from everyone. The fire is in
a really rough location,
just with the fuel. So you have trees that are really older, so almost 200-foot trees, and you have duct, so all of the material underneath the ground that's vertical that could go down 4 to 6 feet. So essentially, 200 feet of vegetation that can go. That's from underneath the ground to the top of the trees, which is an incredible amount of fuel that can burn. And so, a lot of the smoke that you see, the column definitely starts small and it grows, it gets really big and puffy, and that's just all that water that's just being released and burning out there. So, definitely looks very impressive when it does that. It makes it really, really hard to put that fire out with just that amount of fuels that can burn there. And so, like I said, yeah, probably at the end of that first day, definitely had grown quite a bit, and we were at that point preparing for our IC, and we had ordered the team earlier in the day.
We know that.
Great basic team, so that's what I got for it.
Okay, thank you, Jeremy. Evans is going to give us an operations update. This is our incident commander, Evans Paul.
Good evening, everybody. Normally we have our operations secretary come up and give you this update, but given the fact that we've only been on the ground for a little more than 24 hours, my preference was for those folks to be out on the ground, making sure that they're free from this fire out, because there's quite a bit of complexity out there, so I wanted them to focus their time developing a good assessment and the plans, and I told them I covered. They gave you a pretty good update about an hour or so ago. So for those who's supposed to can see the map, and I apologize for the people over here, you might want to see if you can sit where you can see. What you're looking at is the curve as of about 10 o'clock last night. We did an infrared flight and we mapped the fire at approximately 1,226 acres. east side of the fire and on the south side of the fire. For example, a little piece of fire right here is approximately about 100 feet away from the 14 road right now. So just to give you the basic orientation, if you're familiar with the roads in this area, this is the 14 road that runs along the rooftop. This is the 12 road that goes up and over, and then the 1210 goes through the middle of the fire. So right now, yesterday the fire did cross the south fork of Cedar Creek, and it started working its way up the slope towards to the south, but today it has not crossed the 14 road, and we're doing quite a bit of effort right now to try to keep it from crossing that road. When we took over from the other folks, they put a lot of effort into keeping the fire to the south of the 12 road because of a lot of the valleys that are down here in waterworks, the structures, the water treatment plants, the chlorine, as well as some historic structures in the area. So we're continuing along with that same basic strategy right now because it seems to be working. As long as the winds are more or less coming out of the west, we're having good success keeping the fire south of the 12 road, north of the 14 road, and we are looking at a way to cut it off to connect the 12 road to the 14 road. It's pretty steep in there, so unfortunately we can't really use heavy equipment or dozers in there, but we do have an anchor that was looking at that operation today to see if they can establish a control line to keep further spread the fire going this way. A lot of the aircraft activity that we've been doing today, once the inversion shifted, was to try to work on cooling off this flank to keep it from impacting this road or even jumping that road. And then there was a little bit of clear air on the north side where we were able to get in there.
It's okay.
Okay, I'm sorry. Unfortunately, the head of the fire where we really would also like to drop with the aircraft, we can't get in there with the smoke. The visibility is just too occluded. For the most part, our aviation operations are concentrated using the scoopers. You may have seen them. They're dipping water out of the Columbia River. It's the kind of planes that will skim across the waterways and fill up the water tank. And it's a pretty quick turnaround for them to come in. And then all our helicopters have been working, collecting water out of reservoir number one to the north that has a little bit more water. And so that shortens up the turnaround time for them. So it is buying us quite a bit to use those aircraft in conjunction with the crews on the ground. But one of the problems we're dealing with, and as Jeremy mentioned, is it's a super dense canopy. So imagine we've got all this tree canopy and the brush canopy overshadowing the fire. So every time we drop, we have to drop with enough force for the water to actually penetrate through that canopy and actually make it to the fire on the ground. So that's one of the challenges that we've been running into. The other challenge that we have is this being a municipal watershed, use of retardant is not a good idea, especially if it gets in the waterway. I mean, retardant for the most part is mostly fertilizer, but the nitrates at high enough concentrations that it gets in the waterway, that wouldn't be good. So we're having to be very judicious where we use that retardant. So mainly up on the rooftops, out of waterways. But so right now, with the use of the scoopers and the type of helicopters dropping just straight water, we're able to draw wherever we need to, wherever the crews need to put that water on the ground to help them with their ground operation. So our primary objectives with this fire is to suppress it. We want to try to do our best to minimize the fire size and the intensity. The primary reason for that is this is the municipal watershed for approximately, I think, 1 million people. So having this fire get too big would be detrimental to that, to the water quality, and then having a fire burn at high severity, again, would also be detrimental to the future down the road with the sedimentation and erosion. So those are the primary things that we're trying to do is minimize the fire size, suppress it at the small end, and keep it as far away from the valleys as possible down along the Portland Water Bureau, with the water treatment works. We're also aware that we have power lines to the south. We're aware that we have communities along Highway 26, Marmot Road, Brightwood, sorry. I'm from Idaho. And then we're also aware that we have communities off to the west. So these are all things that we've been working Sheriff's Office, the local police department, the various fire departments, and the state marshal's office to develop contingency plans in the event that we're unable to keep the fire contained inside this road network, and the fire forces our hand and starts pushing out of that area, and ultimately it expands. So if it expands, then it could potentially threaten more bodies to the south and the east and the southeast, or even including the west. So that, now that we have the time, we're working with all those partner agencies to develop those contingency plans of what would we do in the event that those things happen, establish what we call trigger points, so that if the fire made it to a certain point on the map and had a good head of steam on it, then we already have our plans worked out for who would be notified, put them in a higher alert status that hey, now it's time to start securing your animals, your livestock, pack some valuables, important papers, prescriptions, photos, those type of things, and be ready, and have to elevate the evacuation level to an even higher status. Ultimately, that if we have to call people up and say, now is the time to be, we don't want to do it in a rush, we prefer to do it in a nice, orderly manner, just to everybody's safety is a primary concern for ours. As Jordan alluded to, this fire is not the most straightforward fire. There's a lot of challenges that we're having to overcome. The heavy fuel loading being one of them. It's been quite a long time since we've had any other type of disturbance in this area. In other words, a fire star or any other type of treatment in there that would reduce the intensity. Analogy I'd like to use is most of us mow our lawns once a week, maybe, sometimes twice a week at the peak growing season. What happens if you say you mow your lawn only every once every 2 weeks? So it's incredibly hard, right, to mow that lawn. What happens if you mow your lawn only once a month? It's even harder. Say you neglect your lawn for the entire summer. What happens? You're probably going to need more than just a lawnmower. And it's going to take you a long time to get your lawn looking decent again. We're kind of in that situation here. Since we've been here, we've been told that it's been not just a matter of decades since the fire burned in here, but 600 years, I think. Christopher Columbus. We're back to Christopher Columbus. So that's a long time for fuels to accumulate out there, multi-story camp. Everything that is conducive to a very large fire and difficult for us to suppress. I mean, if it was on our supplying lighter fire, lighter fuels, grass inventory, that they could really store, but this is not that fire. So we do have a few challenges. We have to come. The other factor that we have to contend with is we're in the peak of the Western fire season right now. I believe in the last 48 hours, between Oregon and Washington, they've received 120 new starts, and that's in addition to the 8 or 10 large fires that are already going on that have teams on them. The good news is some of the fires, like the ones that everybody still can, they're starting to have good success and wind things up, so hopefully that means a lot of those resources can be repurposed elsewhere in the state. But in the last couple of days, with all the lightning on the western slope in the Willamette Valley, we've had over 100 new starts, and each one of those fires is, they're all demand resources. So we are in competition with just about everybody else. We believe we can make a good case with all the values that we have here to say, hey, this is a high priority fire. But then again, we could bet that there's somebody like me on every fire saying, we have a high priority fire because we also have values too, be it on the land, the Umpqua, down on the road. So we are in competition with resources. Right now, nationally, we have about 20,000 firefighters deployed across the country, and that's getting pretty close to our maximum. In years past, we've been able to rely on international support from our partners up in Canada, but if you've been watching the news, you probably know that this year, Canada is experiencing a very abnormal fire season, and they're pretty busy. So I don't think you can count on any support from them. But we're doing the best we can with what we have. We think we're going to have some additional resources coming in to help us do what we need to do to protect the values that we're concerned about. But as things develop, we'll continue to keep you guys updated with as much information as possible on a daily basis. So if you have questions, I think we'll be time for Q&A afterwards, so we'll be around to help address any of those. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I really apologize for the sound issues we're experiencing, and for those on the line, fortunately, we'll just try and keep answering those questions as we are here. So next up, we have Daniel from Clackamas County. Hi, Daniel.
Thank you. I'm Daniel Matt from Clackamas County Disaster Management. The county's Clackamas County's Emergency Operations Center is activated, and we're obviously working in coordination with the incident management team, first responders, and other partners for this fire. We're planning for contingencies related to any potential changes in growth or activity in fire. We're working on establishing possible evacuation zones, looking for air quality, working with partners on sheltering location, and also an active communication with the city and the incident management team and other responders. Just to be clear, no evacuation notices have been sent out at this point. We have identified thresholds for potential evacuations. We have the initial threshold here, which is the road that my friend was talking about, that 14 road. And if the fire were to cross and establish itself across that road, we would be looking to be sending a level one evacuation to this area, which is south of the border of the Mount Hood National Forest and north on the Sandy River, going west from the Barlow Bayside Park to east of approximately 18500 Southeast Monmouth Road. And to be clear, what we're looking for is this fire to establish itself over there. The incident management team, firefighters on the ground, have done a great job of keeping that 14 road. So we're looking at this process for a little bit and then put that spot out. We're not going to do it, we're going to wait in conjunction with that incident management team to determine that that fire has crossed and established itself across that road before we send out that notification. Like I said, we're working to identify shelter locations for individuals that may have to evacuate if they get. And to be clear, this is a level one be ready notice that we're putting, not a lead, but be ready. So this is when we want you to check your go kits, make sure you've got gas in the car, everything that Mike was talking about, make sure you've got your documents, your prescription, all of that stuff, have it ready and see you by the door. But we are working on identifying shelter locations for individuals that need shelter, for animals. So in the meantime, we've got to get you that alert and that notification. So please go to public alerts to ensure that you can see these notifications. It's our best way to reach you. Sign up for your work location, particularly your home location, if you're in here. You can sign up mobile addresses there, you can sign up mobile people. So if you want you and a partner and kids to all sign up, and you can sign up your family members that are far away so that they'll receive a notification for you. I'm happy to give you more information on it. To sign up, go to www.clackamas.us/dm/public alerts, and I'm happy to give you that right down for you. If you're not there, if you search Clackamas County Public Alerts, it'll take you right there. If you've already signed up, please log in, update your information, you can change phone numbers, emails, addresses, go change that. If you don't remember that, just sign up again and you can duplicate information pretty easily and probably won't see it before. If evacuation notice is going into effect, here's how we'll get you that information. If you go through the public alert system, it'll go directly to your cell phone or email or the source of notification that you need to sign. We will also be pushing out notifications through our social media, Clackamas County. Follow Clackamas County on Facebook, on Twitter. Also follow Clackamas County Sheriff's Office. Also, public alerts. Those sources will have that information for us. Also, on our county website, if we put out an evacuation notice, it will be a big red banner at the top. Please click the link there. It will take you to a specific page that will have information on wildfires, and then we'll keep just check your kit, make sure you've got everything that you need, change prescriptions, you've got new documentation, you've got kit, and you want to put the right size clothes, do that now, and do that under level one. Once you reach level two, that's when you want to put that bag in the car. That's when you want to make sure your car's got gas that's in there. If you have any mobility issues, which you would have concerns about being able to leave, if you've got livestock or something like that to move, you may want to start moving at this level two area. And finally, level three, that's go. That's go right now. That is not the time to go back and look at your kit. That is go now. Get in your car and start driving. And we will send those alerts out and get that notification.
Thank you, Daniel. Okay, so our Abbott, Deputy Forest Supervisor for the Navajo National Forest.
Yes, good evening, everybody. So I am here representing the Navajo National Forest, so that's where I work, but also wanted to let you know I'm representing a number of other folks involved in this. This is, as you've heard from multiple speakers ahead of me tonight, this is a multi-agency approach to this, all hands on deck. Everybody is working to cooperate and coordinate and doing what they can to make sure we can handle this incident as quickly as we can. So again, the objective here is to keep this as small as possible, to get it contained as fast as possible, to maintain it here on National Forest to the extent possible. And in doing that, though, it takes a lot of coordination with everyone else that you've already heard. Right from the very beginning, as Jeremy mentioned at the start of this, we had multiple agencies responding, multiple agencies involved, doing everything they could to get around this as fast as possible. Unfortunately, with weather and topography, the way they come together, it makes it impossible sometimes to get in that first couple of shifts. And that's where we are today, but we were able to request some assistance. We've got Evans and the Great Basin team, and they bring a lot of additional resources, a lot of additional experience and background, and knowledge about how to pull these things together. And so we're thankful that they're here to help us. We're all very happy to have the talents here, and they will be adding horsepower to our requests for assistance from across the country, and we hope to see that coming soon. Again, if the objective there is to do as much as we can, keep this on National Forest. There are some other lands, as you see up the blue waterway here, most of that's owned by the Corporal Water Bureau, and those are lands protected by our partners at the Oregon Department of Forestry. We're working very closely with them and watching every day, monitoring the situation, and again with Clackamas County and Emergency Services and Woodland Fire and a host of others. Everybody's working together as one big team to do everything we can to make this event as low impact on the public as possible. But there is going to be some level of frustration and waiting. We understand that as it gets smoky, as it gets hot, and folks continue to do what they can to prevent this from moving out of the containment box that they're hoping for right now. So thank you for your patience, and we are looking forward to answering any questions you have as we move on with this presentation and into our breakout session.
Thank you. So our incident commander, Evans Close, is going to come up with some final remarks from the team.
Okay, so we again. We recognize that we are guests in the community, and we want to be respectful of this is your community. You guys have to live here for a long period of time after the business fires wrapped up. So to that end, we have, in addition to the suppression objectives and the protection of values, we also have another objective, which is to keep the communities as informed as possible, maintain the relationships that the Forest Service and Oregon Department of Forestry have with the communities, the trust, and the respect. So we try to be an open book, as transparent as possible, and get as much information out possible, given what we know, and try to put it out in a timely manner. There's a lot of tricks we can play, and the PIOs are masters at this, everything from social media to in-person contacts, leaflets, flyers, media releases. So we're very interested in input from you folks, what works best for you. because we brought with us enough energy for the people dedicated to the public information side of things, but we want to know what is it that you need to know, how do you need to know it, so we can best serve the community and also redeem our responsibilities as guests in your community. So, I guess before I hand off the mic and sit down, does anybody have any questions for me in particular? I'd be more than happy to address them. Yes, sir. Do we need to pitch on a mic?
Have you guys set out the 14 road, widened it out so it won't jump it? Yeah. Have you guys widened out the 14 road, cut it out so it won't jump it?
We've been doing a little widening of the road network. Right now we have not bought in any heavy equipment, but we're working with the local agency resource advisor to figure out how we best think about doing that.
Yeah.
Because once we start taking out big trees, we create a big old mess. And then the question is, what do we do with the trees? Not only the logs, but also the vernal vegetation, the vernal tops and the limbs, and it's a big deal. So it's something that we can do. We're considering it. We're looking at the need for it. But we're having a further discussion with the agency regarding, is this the appropriate tactic and the appropriate time and place for it? Any other questions? Yes, sir. If you don't mind, now.
Before I move too far, where is Aaron? I told him
know what? I'd like to thank. I would like to thank, first of all, first responders here who showed up to integrate what they're doing. We recognize there's some assets that are important to protect, right? And those are equally important to our community. And then more important, maybe for some than water, is standing. The 424 square miles that our school district serves. So we know that you have our best interest in mind, and our hope is that we get all those questions answered today. And so I think the least of those is the question about air quality of the AQI and what that means for our school district. As you might know, air quality in our fires can fluctuate, and some folks are wondering if we're going to start school on time as of right now. We plan to. I think the air quality index goes from 0 to 50. That's kind of regular, that's normal. 50 to 100 starts to become moderate. 100 to 150, it gets unhealthy for a certain population above 150. All bets are off, right? So communicate using the normal channels that we communicate through. If you're a parent, or you may be even a grandparent in our school district, you can probably get access to Parent Square, or you're on our Facebook page, and our website can be found. So look for us to post that on a daily basis until this subsides. Beginning on September 5th. So that's the actual start of school. And those air quality indices matter to us, and we'll keep a close eye on those. We'll let you know as soon as possible if and when there is school closure. All right. And once again, thank you to the folks that are here to protect our community, the water, and the human capital that are our people and our children. So thank you.
So currently, under the westerly wind, as well as the way the terrain flows, this is kind of more or less the uphill direction. And so fires like to burn uphill more readily than they do downhill. So we're seeing the natural progression of fire in the absence of wind in that direction, but then as we have mostly a westerly or northwesterly wind, it's been pushing the fire both east as well as south. As far as Little Sandy River, I think, was that the reference?
Community
of Welch's. I believe Welch's is quite a ways out still from this fire, so at this point in time, it's none of our modeling is showing it making it that far. As far as the Little Sandy River to the south, it is possible. It's not outside the realm of possibility, especially if we continue to get a northerly type of wind flow on this fire. But as the fire progresses and moves, we'll be giving you guys continuous updates. One of the questions that I also got online earlier was somebody asked us to repeat the size of the fire. As of 10 o'clock last night, it was mapped at 1,226 acres. We're anticipating probably a little bit of growth today, and if we get our infrared flight
check, we'll have it up.
If we get our infrared flight tonight, we'll have an updated
acres
for you in the morning.
All right, we had another question that you might be able to answer for us too. With the prospect of changes in weather, possible humidity, does that increase your optimism?
It does to some extent. So right now the weather forecast that we have is the high pressure system that's been dominating our area for this week is supposed to start moving off to the east, and the higher temperatures will be impacting the eastern part of the state. Behind the high pressure, we're getting another low pressure system, which is supposed to bring a little bit cooler temperatures, higher humidities, and a possible chance of rainfall on Tuesday. Right now, the forecast that we have is about 15 to 30% possibility for a wetting rain, which is maybe up to a quarter inch. The reason why I'm not filled with super high level optimism is because It's most likely going to get breezy, so winds 15, 20 miles an hour, which would adversely affect this fire, will continue to push it to the east and southeast. That's a given that we're going to get the winds. Right now, the precipitation amount at 15 to 30% likelihood, that's not enough for me to bet the bankroll on. So what we are hoping to go for is the cooler temperatures and the higher humidities, both of those which will help to moderate the fire behavior. But on the other hand, with the wind, that kind of offsets things. So right now the forecast is not the best forecast in the world, but then again, it's not the worst. So I'm trying to be not too pessimistic, but at the same time, not overly optimistic either. I'm just being real with the folks.
All right, and we had another question from someone online who wanted to know if there's any possibility that the power will be shut off in the area of the fire as they only get Wi-Fi and cell service when they have power.
It's probably best that we defer to emergency service to answer this. I mean, we provide the recommendations. That's our role. We don't have control over cutting off the power. But what we would do in the event that the fire made a strong push, jump the 14 road and started working its sustained way to the south, if we felt like it was going to impact the transmission power line to the south, then we would make that recommendation. But it's not really our call.
So I don't want to speak too much for PGE here, but their plan for the public safety power shutoffs is to do that when there's a high wind and high heat, these are red flag warning shutoffs. So we have been in touch with PGE. They do not have plans under the current weather conditions to do that. If they do that, they will be messaging out through their systems and through the county systems to do so.
Okay, no more questions from online. Do you have, would you like to step up?
Thank you.
Fire and Camp Creek Fire Facebook, which I know is difficult with internet issues, which we really enjoyed tonight. But also, we will have a track line where we set up information stops throughout the community, and we will be looking at Highway 26, at placing information boards there, where we will update the information daily. But I am going to pass this to O'Neill and Daniel to address how you could get awards and what evacuation would look like.
Yeah, good evening. I'm Captain Brad O'Neill with Pikes County Sheriff's Office. I work in partnership with disaster management when it comes to evacuations. I hear you, any other question? This fire is different than in 2020. 2020, those fires started in multiple locations very quickly in populated areas. This is the first time that we've been able to have some time to do a bunch of pre-planning and actually use the alert system the way it should be, where we started a one, moved to a two, and then moved to a three. It's actually exciting for us to see this model in the way that it is actually designed to work. Mother Nature doesn't always give us that grace to start at a one. And so Daniel and I will be over here at evacuations during the breakout. But as of right now, we are planning out different areas and some of those trigger points for those evacuations. But all those evacuations go through me at the Sheriff's Office, and I rely heavily upon my firefighters and the incident management team to give me their expertise on what the fire is doing, how quickly it's moving, of course, the weather plays into that effect. But we're on call 24/7 from here on out. If we need to come in and start dealing with stuff because the wind changes, that's what we're here for.
And one other way, just because of our science tank, definitely about the lack of communication and connectivity. If you have someone outside of your area that has connectivity, sign them up with your address. And they can get an alert if they have a means like radio, where you're driving to, letting you know that something has changed. When there's level 1, 2, 3 alerts come out, that can be a way to do it. I understand that there's always working ways to communicate together, but that can be a way to do it. You can have a friend or family member get a notification for you and help you get that information. I'm happy to talk to any of that information about other ways to get
Thank you. Yes, there's one more question.
Hi, my name is Jenny, and I have a friend who was able to be here that is asking if there's going to be translation for the Latin community in Spanish.
We are working on that, so I'm working to get a Spanish interpreter. Thank you.
This isn't a question, but I want to thank the Portland Water Barrel Control, who called pushed the direct line to the fire station and Clackamas 371. You were awesome. Corbett guys that came out were awesome and ran a drone to find that fire. You guys were out there in the middle of the night fighting that, trying to find that fire, and I appreciate that. They got right on it. And you guys currently working on it. Thank God you're here.
I'm going to end the live portion of this because we've had enough with the microphones today. But I would like you to join us at the mats around the room. We are not leaving. We are still here to answer your questions. So evacuations will be over here with O'Neill and Daniel. Back over here, we'll have water questions. We have the City of Sandy and Portland Water Bureau. Over here, we will have some of our fire operations firefighters. So if you have any strategy tactics questions, and then right back here, we have for the forest to answer any questions related to Mount Hood National Forest, and we will have OBF present too. And then media, please head that way, and we'll do our best to get to you after the public questions. Just want to reiterate to everyone, please follow the Camp Creek Fire Facebook page and find us on NC Web. Thank you so much.